Thank you, Bill. Julian, welcome, and guests, welcome. It's a customary thing at St. Thomas More Forum to have a short reflection before the main event of the evening. And I'd like to put these thoughts before you. We are now 3 months into the year of mercy proclaimed by Pope Francis, and recently he made a statement on capital punishment. He said it's opposed, it is the opposite of divine mercy, which should be the model of our man-made legal systems. He said capital punishment is cruel, inhumane, and an offence to the dignity of human life, and that in today's world the death penalty is inadmissible, however serious the crime that has been committed. He makes it clear that justice can never be done by killing another human being, and he stressed that there is no humane way of carrying out a death sentence. This set me thinking, and I thought of the Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 5, verse 21, when Jesus said, "You have heard that it was said to the men of old, you shall not kill, and whoever kills is liable to judgment. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother shall be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother shall be liable to the council, and whoever says, 'You fool,' shall be liable to hell fire." One way of looking at these words is to say that things which we often take as part of ordinary life, like a little anger here and there, a little frustration here and there, when these things are treated so seriously, we see how much more serious the act of killing another human being is. Jesus faced state-sanctioned execution in a most horrendous way. He was condemned by false evidence and executed because of political expediency. The discussion in the Sanhedrin is recorded by St. John in St. John's Gospel, chapter 11, 48. "If we let him go on thus," talking of Jesus, "everyone will believe in him, and the Romans will come and destroy our holy place and our nation." And in verse 50, Caiaphas says, "You do not understand that it is expedient for you that one man should die for the people and that the whole nation should not perish." John sees this as a prophetic statement of Jesus' salvational death, not understood by the Sanhedrin. So in verse 33, John writes, "So from that day on, they took counsel how to put him to death." The thought came to me of how many thousands upon thousands of people have been killed by the state for political expediency. St. Thomas More was also put to death by the state, accused by false evidence of treason, when he, in good conscience, was not able to sign the oath to Henry as head of the Church of England, even though he was pleaded to do so by his beloved daughter Margaret, for she saw it as a simple thing to do to save his life. So he was beheaded on the 6th of July, 1535, and his last words were, "I die the king's good servant, but God's first."
Thank you, Wallace. I'm pleased to introduce to you Julian McMahon. Before I do, I just want to reflect on the 28th of November 2005, on this very podium, we hosted a speaker at the forum who spoke about one of Julian McMahon's clients, Van Nguyen, who was executed in Singapore 5 days later. This speaker spoke about this young Australian who was facing the gallows and who sought comfort from the writings of St. Thomas More. Our speaker in 2005 asked, what is it about Sir Thomas More that more than 500 years after his death, his writings continue to inspire people around the world? Our speaker said that the example of More is timeless because of the principles he stood for. He said More was a man who refused to budge from his principles, which in turn shaped the direction of his conscience, and of course that led to his death by capital punishment. And who was this speaker? It was Kevin Rudd, the then opposition shadow minister for foreign affairs, who spoke that night on the topic modern labour in the Catholic Church. So I thought to myself, there's been a lot of water under many bridges since 28th of November 2005. Tonight, our speaker is Julian McMahon, who acted for Van Nguyen more than 10 years ago. Julian has worked on death penalty cases for over 13 years, including for Myuran, Sukumaran and Andrew Chan, who were executed in Indonesia by firing squad last year. In the months leading up to those two executions, in April 2015, there were overwhelming demands of their case required Julian and other lawyers to make many personal sacrifices. Julian McMahon has been a barrister since 1998 and he works in the criminal law. He is the President of Reprieve Australia, a single-issue organisation opposed to the death penalty. He has been involved in a number of community activities over the years and is on the board, as I said earlier, of Jesuit Social Services. He's worked on capital punishment cases in a number of countries, and tonight he will discuss his own work, the issue of the death penalty more generally, and he will also share his interest in the life and the prison writings of Thomas More. Please welcome Julian McMahon.
To get organised. Well, thank you all very much for coming on this brutally hot evening. And thank you to the people who organised the Thomas More Forum. I think it's a very important thing to have forum fora like this because this is not my notes, by the way, I'm just going random here, but you know, the body politic is not very healthy in many ways, and it's important that citizens from all over the community really step up and engage in ideas in this country at this time, because a lot of ideas need a lot more input from people like us. Anyway, that was not my planned introduction. Kevin Rudd was actually deeply moved by the whole Van Nguyen story and saga. And I didn't know that he spoke here at this time, but I did know him a bit at that time because of that case. And he spoke out passionately about it. And it's true that Van Nguyen, who was executed on 2nd of December 2005, had read the prison writings, some of the prison writings of Thomas More. And in fact, I have in my hand, I'm going to leave a few things on the table for later, show and tell, because I'm out of school. I've got a few pages here, which are the photocopy of what Van Nguyen was reading in preparation for his death. And just a few pages out of a book by Thomas More called De Tristitia, or The Sadness of Christ. And right at the back, there's a few pages on how to treat people who wrong you, and how to think about your imminent death, and Van had those documents, I guess, for 6 months or more in the lead up to his death, and he was well prepared for death, very luckily for him. A nun who was a chaplain at the prison, he met a nun who was a chaplain at the prison in a year or two before he died. And then he, none of this is in my notes, but I'm just kind of interested remembering it all. You know, he then became a Catholic while he was in prison, and he'd really already been a Catholic. And some years later, I was invited to a breakfast. Some years after his death, I was invited to a breakfast at a convent in Melbourne, a Carmelite convent. And there's 20 or 30 Carmelites at that convent in Melbourne, and one of the nuns serving breakfast was a Vietnamese nun. And it turned out that when she was a teenager, a young woman living in Richmond, she had taken some twin boys every Sunday from the flats, the housing commission flats in Richmond, up to the local church for Sunday school. And one of those boys was Van Nguyen and his twin brother. And then years later, here she was giving me breakfast as a Carmelite nun, telling me that story. Anyway, I'm going to talk about a bit about Thomas More and probably an unusual approach to that, which is a field research approach, and about my clients in Indonesia and about the death penalty generally around the world. And I'm sorry to be a bit Bolshevik, but I'm very happy to take questions really at any time, as long as they're short and sharp. Because usually the questions are what you actually want to hear about rather than what I want to tell you about. So don't be shy to ask questions. I can't actually remember where my interest in Thomas More started, but 6 years ago, I was visiting my sister in London, and she was working full-time. I was there on my own for a week, and each evening we'd meet up for dinner. So I had a week to kill, and it was, strangely, given the course of my life, it was actually the first time I'd ever been to London. And so I had 5 or 6 free days, and shockingly, I knew so little about English history, it truly was embarrassing. I didn't know where to begin. I've since found out that I belong to a generation where the Catholic Church in Australia decided not to teach as much about Irish history in order to prevent the troubles travelling across the world. So that's my excuse for not knowing much about British history. I knew a lot more about Rome and Greece, believe me. So there I am in London thinking, where do I begin? You know, which century? And so I just picked Thomas More and Tudor, and I went all over London for a week, chasing him down. And London is not a classless city. So by saying that I was a barrister, doors would open. And sometimes, for instance, I was at a military barracks. By saying I used to be in the army, used to be a commando in the army, other doors would open. So I found myself, you know, passing myself off as a well-educated gentleman, knocking on doors in London and having a great time. And one of the rooms I went into at the Tower of London, I tried to get into the cell where Thomas More had spent the last year of his life. May I just ask, has anyone here been to that? Is that some? So a few people, okay. So it was locked up and hard to get into, and so I knocked on the barracks. It's run as a proper military establishment, the Tower of London. I think you have to be possibly a warrant officer or above, even to be allowed to work there. And I find myself in the mess, surrounded by soldiers, all of them my age, roughly, a pretty tough and unsympathetic lot, frankly. And so I started talking, which is my business, and I kept dropping things about the military and how I really wanted to see the cell where Thomas More had spent his last year of his life. And the guy in charge, he was in charge of the whole Tower of London, on the military side, he began to interrogate me. And thankfully, I had recently read a whole armful of books about the subject, because after he interrogated me for quite some time, he said, okay, I'll let you in. So then we went around and we went through the Tudor rooms that Henry had built, which are still there, and apparently one of the 2 or 3 best remaining examples of Tudor architecture in the whole of England. and you go through those rooms into the room where Thomas More was, and it was a room the size of this front part of the hall, from where Bill is to the door. It was a circular cell in one of those giant turret corners, and it was very rough gravel floor, and the windows were the slits where you can put the guns through. So it was, in a way, it was open to the temperature, whatever the temperature was outside. It was a very harsh environment, and although Moore had spent the first few months in prison in 1534 in some comfort, gradually it became rougher and harder for him there. And as you will know, he was quite the ascetic character, so he didn't mind a bit of doing it rough. But it was wonderful to be in there. And for those of you who haven't been there, I've got some photos which I'll put out on the desk later. And there was just a little table in there where many years earlier, so it was a room that had been open to the public but is now pretty much permanently locked because of some distressing scenes that have happened in there, I think about 20 years ago, when people refused to leave. They'd go in and would literally refuse to leave, so the guards had to have some distressing scenes. So there's a table in there where Cardinal Hume, a table just like this really, had said Mass sometime in the early 90s. You know, it's a beautiful, simple cell, and I was really pleased to be there because I had read quite a few of the books that Thomas More had written while he was in there. Eventually he was writing with charcoal. And for those of you who haven't read what he wrote in that prison cell, for instance, the last letters that he wrote to his family, or De Tristitia, the Sadness of Christ, I personally think they're some of the most impressive reflections in the canon of the Catholic saints. They're very accessible. Some of them are very accessible, and very, very interesting for people like me and probably like you, because he was just a, you know, he was a father, a husband twice, a whole bunch of kids, a whole bunch of problems, eventually coming into conflict, of course, and facing a terrible death. He expected to be hung, drawn, and quartered. He wasn't just at the last moment. So his writings from that cell are great. And as fate would have it, because I'm a barrister in criminal law and have been working in death penalty cases, I've found myself in a number of settings where people are sitting in a room from where they'll be taken to die, to be hung or shot. So I guess that makes it more interesting for me. I'm terrified in the sense, in the Canberra audience, I think probably half of you are professors at ANU or something. So I hesitate to tread into history. But anyway, you know that there were two Acts of Parliament that Moore resisted. One was the Act of Succession concerning the second marriage. And in fact, Thomas More was prepared to swear to that, to sign that, in a limited way. And he made that offer to, I think it was Cromwell, in a letter. Anyway, the letter went to the king, and he came back saying, no, the way he wants to swear will just cause me more trouble than it's worth, so I'm not accepting his offer. And the other act was so he was prepared to accept the succession to some extent, but not the legitimacy of the second marriage, and not in the oath that was required for that act was a recognition that Henry was the head of the church as well. So in fact, the oath, which was required, was broader in its scope than the words of the legislation. He was prepared to accept the legislation to a limited extent, but not the oath, which was broader. So a lawyer to the end, of course. And the other act, the Act of Supremacy, which was about recognizing Henry as the only head of the church in England. He wouldn't sign it, but he never explained why. So, again, as a lawyer working in crime, I do find it edifying to think about how someone as intelligent and thoughtful and virtuous as Thomas More would employ such a brilliant legal strategy. But it truly was brilliant. He never said a word against the king. He never said a word against the act. He said, I won't explain why I'm not going to swear. And you have no right to insist that I do. And furthermore, by my silence, as you well know, the common law says you can imply consent. So he really had them in a bind. He legally, if they had wanted to, they could have said, by his silence, he's agreeing to this. He would never have agreed to it, but they could have chosen to interpret it that way if they wanted to. But of course they didn't. It's said that his silence deafened Europe. It was so loud. And finally, as was mentioned earlier, at his trial, when the indictment is read out against him, there was the evidence from Mr. Rich. And Mr. Rich swore that Thomas More had said certain things about the right of Parliament to replace Henry and what he thought about the legislation and so on. And those things were plainly false. And the people who condemned More knew they were false because More said, effectively, he said, the reason I'm sitting in front of you about to be executed is because I take my conscience seriously and I take an oath seriously. You know that's true because you're about to kill me for that very reason. So let me tell you this. I swear on my soul and I prefer to go to hell than to lie about this. I swear on my soul that I did not say those things to Mr. Rich. He knows they are false. You know they are false. And because I'm about to die because of my conscience, you know that I'm speaking the truth. And the jury went out and convicted him in 15 minutes. So it's just a brilliant moment in history, really. There was someone writing in French who was present, who immediately, within days, everything that was said in the courtroom was being reprinted in France. And Erasmus picked it up straight away as well. And so what happened in the courtroom was up and running as public knowledge very, very quickly. But he was not without a sense of humour. That was about the 1st of July. He was executed on the 6th of July. A day or two after the 1st of July, one of King Henry's courtiers came to Thomas More and said, have you changed your mind? And apparently the courtier, in the older text, he's described as a kind of a lightweight, foolish fellow. So Thomas More said, yes, I've changed my mind. And this dopey courtier was overwhelmed with excitement and raced off to see the king, or whoever was two or three secretarial desks before the king, and said, Thomas More's changed his mind, he's changed his mind. And the question then was, well, about what? And so the courtier gets sent back and asked, well, what have you changed your mind about? And More said, yes, I have changed my mind. I was thinking that before I had my execution, I would shave, but I've decided not to. So, and then apparently that made Henry very angry indeed. He was a funny guy, there's no doubt about it. If you go to Old Chelsea, so some of you will travel to London between now and when we all die. You go down to Chelsea, there's a road, I think it's called Church Road or Old Chelsea Road, one of those two, and there's a church at the bottom, which is where Thomas More's house, garden, church was. And on the river, there's a big statue of Thomas More. And if you read about his life, that's where he jumped on the barge and went up and down to Westminster. Inside that little church, which is no bigger than this hall, there's a... I'm not sure what you call it. When you have it's like a tombstone with all the writing on it. Is it called an epitaph? Plaque. Anyway, it's one of those words. Someone here must know. One of you AMU professors will know. And it's a very long Latin inscription. Now, I actually did an honours degree in Latin and ancient Greek, and you'd think I'd know something about it. But in fact, I couldn't really work out all of the Latin on it. It's quite hard. So he resigned in 1532 and died in 1535. And in that time, he's still at his house in Chelsea. And as you may know, there were many lies being spread about him. And in the decades after his death, there were many more lies spread about him. But he already knew about that. So he was very careful to commit a lot of things to the record. And it's kind of bizarre to think while he's alive, he wrote this long, you know, it's like 40 or 50 lines, maybe 40 lines, epitaph about his whole life, saying who he was, what jobs he had, what jobs his father had. And the whole purpose is to keep a good record. And it also has things about, serving the king and loving the king and so on. Anyway, as you may know, his first wife, Alice, died after giving him a number of children. She died very young. Oh no, Jane. And then he went off and married Alice, who was, as Erasmus very cruelly said, neither a pearl nor a girl. So he said it in Latin, of course. But anyway, Moore married her to, I think she might have been a bit of hard work for him, but she looked after his kids very well, and that's what he wanted. He married her a month after his first wife died. So, on this epitaph, I'm saying epitaph. Can someone learn a nod and say, is that the right word? Epitaph. He says that he goes through his whole life and he says, and here is buried my first wife, and here shall be buried my second wife with me, and death shall grant what life denied, meaning I can be with both my wives at once forever. So he's always making jokes like that. In fact, in my front garden, I have a mulberry tree. And the reason I have a mulberry tree is in his back garden, which I have knocked on doors and gone in to see, he had a mulberry tree. And he planted the mulberry tree because in Latin, the word for mulberry tree is moria, or can be morus, I think. But also the Latin for being a complete fool is morus. So morus said, I'm a complete fool, so I might as well plant a mulberry tree. And it's still there, and I've been there and sat there. Getting a long way from a learned talk, Bill. Anyway, I knocked on the front door of what is now a Catholic seminary, just by coincidence, and I said I wanted to come and see the garden, which was Thomas More's garden, and you know, some confused seminarian found himself being pushed around by gentlemen from the colonies, and you know, there I was walking through the house as if I owned it, looking in all these rooms where there were things related to Thomas More, and out into the garden is this beautiful mulberry tree. Which is why I have a mulberry tree in my front yard, if any of you ever visit. In fact, in that seminary, there's a little cupboard in a little room, just a little sitting room. And in that cupboard, it's full of relics of Thomas More, almost none of which I've ever seen referred to in any scholarly book or text. It's a room where, in fact, people like Chesterton and Belloc used to give talks well over 100 years ago now. And there's some little memorabilia about Thomas More, and there's his cupboard. So some of you will know he used to wear a hair shirt, and he was sent that to his daughter the day before he died. So there's a little box where the hair shirt was in, and there's a little piece of jewellery about that size, said to have been made by a person who knew Thomas More personally. And it's just a picture of his face, but a very vivid picture. And there's half a dozen other things that history has forgotten, which are just sitting in this glass cupboard in the... It's a building which is now called the Allen Seminary. And the reason I found it is because I worked out that's where Thomas More's house was, which is long since demolished. But I knew about his garden, and I thought that in the back of his garden there was this little study room and chapel where he used to go every day from 2 a.m. to 7 a.m., mind you. So you can imagine being Chancellor of England, working very hard, and then he would get up at 2 a.m. and go out to this study for 5 hours every day. So I'm trying to find, I'm knocking on doors and, you know, into the very well-spoken citizens of Chelsea, unaccustomed to people like me, I can tell you. And so I had good fun there. So what do we learn from Thomas More and all that? It is worth reading what you can and studying about Thomas More's death, because it's so relevant to today. In the face of the power of the state, the abuse of law, the failure of the rule of law, he maintained some extraordinary disciplines. He didn't speak badly about the people who were treating him badly. He did speak the truth or remain silent. He spoke truth to power, as we would now say, which I believe is a Quaker expression, but if anyone can correct me later, I'd like to know about that. His death was combined with courage, generosity. He was warm to everybody around him as he went to his death. And this is where I wish the video wasn't running. You know, some of those things I've spoken about to my own clients who are facing execution. And although not in the context of Catholic faith, but in the context of them saying, you know, what's going to happen, etc., etc., and, you know, trying to give them some advice. But preparing for this talk, I was actually struck by the long list of similarities, which I really won't go through here, but because Myuran, Sukumaran and Andrew Chan were definitely, most definitely not saints. Even when they died, they were not saints. They were scallywags at best in many ways. But even so, they were given many months to prepare for their death. They arrested in 05, they were sentenced to death three times within 12 months, and then slowly the Australian lawyers like Lex Lasry and myself got involved, but we never recovered the ground that was initially lost way back then. And in January 2015 they were told they were going to die very soon. You may remember that the President of Indonesia said in December 2014, everyone who's a drug convict on death row is going to be executed soon, all 64 of you. And it was said earlier tonight that executions are political. Well, that was a purely political statement. With respect to the President, he'd been a President for 2 months at that point, less than 2 months. He hadn't campaigned on it to get elected. In fact, he was elected in part by the whole human rights lobbies of Indonesia pushing for his election, because he seemed to be outside the old guard and all the problems that the old guard had. He didn't know where those cases were at in the legal system, and in fact, of those 64 people, 14 have been executed, not 64. Of those, I think 12 are foreigners, which is not a statistical probability worth dwelling on for long. And even those 12, including my clients, of course, still had numerous steps available in the legal process. And some of the others had more fundamental, more basic steps in the legal process well and truly available to them, even upon the announcement of the fact that they were soon to be killed. So my clients were told in January they would be killed, that their clemency had been rejected. I won't take you through all the legal steps we went through in the next 4 months, but by early February or late January, they knew, it turned out to be inaccurate, but they knew that they were going to be executed in February. The position had been made clear that they would be dead in February. As it turned out, they died on the 29th of April, so they had a lot of time to contemplate their death. And you may know that the way they died was really quite spectacular. Just keep my eye on the watch.
The beginning of March, they were moved to
it's called the Death Island, where it's just a small island. I think it might be 10 kilometres long, where there's a lot of prisons, about 7 prisons, part of the Dutch heritage. And they're in a pretty tough prison, and the execution was imminent, days away. Usually when you got moved there, you died within 3 days or something like that. Anyway, it didn't happen for a whole lot of reasons, some of which you saw on the TV. And when they got to the prison, they were still very scared, but they were ready to die. But then, as luck would have it, as fate would have it, they actually had another 8 weeks to live, in which time they really transformed themselves into leaders. They were already leaders in the other prison, but they'd been there a long time. But by the time they died in this new prison, a very tough prison, they were leaders again. And so they immediately set to work on winning over all the people around the prison, which was a bold ambition. It's hard to convey what it's like to walk into a prison on an island called Death Island, where you're walking in the gate with clients who have maybe 3 or 4 or 5 days to live, and a whole lot of guards who have to manage the problem, and who are anticipating a great deal of trouble. One of the many injustices inflicted on Sukumaran and Chan was that despite having radically and brilliantly and wonderfully transformed a significant part of the prison that they just spent many years in, they were treated as extremely dangerous people for the political purpose of moving them from Bali to Nusakambangan. So instead of moving them in a simple way, as some of the other prisoners were then moved over the next few weeks who were then shot, it involved ships, fighter jets with missiles, armoured personnel carriers, APCs, hundreds of troops, and these two boys went through all that, and they arrived bringing a reputation which was completely undeserved for being troubled. Within 8 weeks, the guards of the prison clearly loved them because they were great young men at that stage. And they were very generous in their words and their actions all day, every day. The first thing they did when they got to a death row in this prison, there was one other bloke there called Rahim. He'd been on death row also for many, many years, and for some reason he was pulled out of a large number of people on death row to die with my clients. And he had nothing. My clients were spoiled prisoners by the standards of local Indonesian prisoners. They had Westerners coming in with, you know, goods, from toiletries to food to, in the other prison in Bali, all kinds of, paints, canvas, all that kind of thing. None of that was allowed in the new tough prison, but they gradually won over the guards. They kept asking for things. The first thing they did for Rahim was they said, everything that we get, Andrew Myuran, he has to get the same. So suddenly, those of us who were helping look after the prisoners were looking after 3 prisoners, not 2, which, you know, they found very amusing. So Rahim, in fact, had virtually no privileges for a long time. So as soon as he got some money in his account, he went to the canteen, which was very basic, and bought a box of little containers of carnation milk, which he just gorged himself on for some days. So excited was he to get that treat. But anyway, he was such a lovely man, Rahim. You know, I saw him at length on the day he died. He had become quite religious. He was a real Bible studier. And people who don't understand prisoners and prisons think, oh yeah, they just do that because they want to get out of prison. But it's such a misunderstanding to think like that. If you're in a cell and you're going to die, and no one cares about you, and you know sooner or later you're going to be taken out and shot, and if you get hold of 1 or 2 books, well, what are you going to do? You can't read Harry Potter endlessly or whatever. So, you know, it's natural for people in prison to be drawn to religion because they lead such ascetic lives. And you confront it every day with good and evil. I could spend the rest of the night just talking to you stories about where Andrew and Myuran were confronted with good and evil, and they had to fight to win the choice, to make the right choice. You know, if you're running an art room in a prison and gangsters are muscling in on you for all kinds of purposes, sordid purposes, every day you have to fight back. Every day you're faced with choices, take the easy route or take the hard route. Anyway, so on the last day of his life, Rahim was on his knees. There was a girl who was visiting him. I don't know how or why, it's not uncommon. And she was weeping, and he was kneeling in front of her, you know, smiling at her and counseling her and helping her get through his imminent execution, which I could see happening all around me. And I was sitting next to for hours that day, sitting next to Mary Jane Veloso, who some of you will know, she's a Philippine woman. She's sitting there, and she had her two little sons with her, who were about 5 and 10. And she was going to be shot that night. And she's holding her boys, one of whom understood, one of whom didn't. And the one who didn't sang in this song, you know, it was like 20 verses. I could not possibly remember a song with so many verses. It just went on and on and on. And she's whispering in his ear, and he's singing the song, and she's hugging him and looking at him, and I'm knowing that she's looking at him thinking, this is the last time I'm going to hug you, and you are smuggling chocolate into it. When you're in a setting like that, you don't need to be a lawyer or well-versed in the law or understanding a capital punishment to see how fundamentally wrong it is. Now, she was about to be shot, but because of some events which none of us knew about, that might have happened in the Philippines. Just before they all got taken out to be shot, she was pulled aside. So the Indonesian system had her dead in the water, but the Philippine system intervened. In fact, we're on the island when they all got shot, 8 of them, and her family were next to me on the dock, and the killing field was just over a few hundred yards away. And when the shots rang out, the family is in uncontrollable grief and weeping because they knew that their family member had just been shot. But they were mistaken. Well, she had not been shot, but everything was in the dark and she'd been pulled out just before that. And her case is now a live political issue between the Philippines and Indonesia. No one's interrupted me with any questions. And I haven't been as structured as my notes have led me to want to be, but it's hard to know what to say if we're going into the Catholic Forum, the Thomas More Forum, where for all I know none of you are Catholics, or for all I know all of you are on the local Catholic board, I just don't know. So, I guess I'm trying to convey to you a human thinking and feeling about people on death row. It's easy to talk about those things as if you know everything when you know almost nothing. And I see a lot of that, you know, people come up to me and say, oh, they should die because, and they'll get some factually erroneous proposition, or some cold, calculating, and unfeeling proposition. But the more you know about prisoners, the more you know about their whole life, you know, the more you know about what they do in prison, the more you know about how politics invades the space of justice when it comes to executions, the clearer it all becomes that it's a nonsense to think that there's something just about taking people out and killing them. All executions that I'm aware of are pillaged. And Thomas More is a great example of that. Sukumaran and Chan were an example of that. You know, the politics of it all just took over from December 2014. And I started to talk about them, comparing them, but reflecting on some of the similarities between them and Thomas More. So when Thomas More was sentenced to death and in the court taken back to the tower, as he's going into the tower, his daughter comes up and grabs him and hugs him again and again, and the guards are weeping. And on the day that Myuran Andrew and the others are executed, the guards are also deeply distraught. And the last thing that Myuran did at the prison before he was taken away to be shot was to hug all these guards and to tell them that he loved them and he forgave them and all that kind of stuff. You know, they were in such a terrible position. I forget the English. There was one of the Lords of England who was speaking. speaking about the French after the war and said, you just can't judge people who act when they're under occupation. And it's a bit like that with prison guards. Many of the prison guards I dealt with in that prison were lovely people. All the prisoners who died, the day, the ones that I knew, there were eight that I was in part of that scene, and there were about five that I got to know and had some really in-depth talks to. And they were all very calm and ready to die. And as they were being taken in the dark and shackled to the field to be shot, you know, Andrew Chan yelled out a roll call, which I think they must have worked out only then that Mary Jane Veloso was not dead. As they left the prison, they were all singing Amazing Grace. As they were taken and to be, they were strapped up so that their arms were like this on the blocks. They were all singing and calling out to each other. They didn't have blindfolds, at least the ones I know of, they didn't have blindfolds. So they died with enormous dignity and generosity. And one of the last things that Myuran said, as in one of the two or three last sentences he said, was he wanted God to bless Indonesia, to forgive everyone who was involved in what was happening. There are a lot of other things that it's really just too early to talk about because for all kinds of reasons. But everyone involved that I know about, and that's quite a lot of people, was really profoundly moved by what they were witnessing. It wasn't, some of you might know about sea executions in Iran or Saudi Arabia, which just look so utterly cruel and God forsaken. You line up a row of prisoners in Iran, you put a noose around their necks, you lift up the crane, they're all dead. They're swinging in the public marketplace. So I'm going to finish with a few comments about what's happening in the world today about the death penalty. So now I'm putting a bit of a political or moral injunction on you to pay attention to the world around you, because if we don't speak out against whatever injustices we see, then we're failing. You know, we just have to. And I don't know where you all fit in society, but we should be aware of the things that are happening which are bad, which we have to deal with. For instance, you all know that in the last 12 months, the Western countries have engaged so much more with Syria. Pardon me, I'm thinking about Syria for another reason, with Iran. And it's a major political shift in the world. As to how, you know, lifting the sanctions on Iran, what that means, for the balance of power in the Middle East and the wealth that is suddenly back, pouring back into Iran. Well, in that same time, executions in Iran have skyrocketed. So now Iran is executing about 20 people a week, about three a day. We constantly engage in one way or another with Saudi Arabia. Since the new king of Saudi Arabia has become king, executions have significantly increased. Now it's at least three a week. And they're such debasing spectacles. You can see them, not that I suggested we do, but they're on the internet. It's like going to the footy. You wander over to the local open area marketplace, a crowd of men gather around, of course it's all men. They're smoking, they're talking. In the middle, there's a few men in robes moving around. There's a prisoner kneeling, and there's a beheading. A few more cigarettes, a bit more talk, and move on. And several times a week in Saudi Arabia. And, you know, what do we, as a community, as a government, when we're dealing with them, say that? I don't need to talk to this audience about China and the USA. Most developers will be known to all of you. Pakistan may not be known to you so much. Pakistan had gone for a long time without executing until some terrible terrorist incidents in 2014. Then they said it's time to start executing terrorists. From December 2014, they've been executing about four people a week. But most of them are not terrorists, they're just any old criminal. They've got 8,000 people on death row in Pakistan. And they're just pulling them out several a week. And whenever the media or Amnesty or a foreign government gets hold of the details of the case, they're almost invariably shocking. I've been saying a few times, all executions are political, so the solution is you have to get it off the statute books. You don't just have to say we're not going to do it anymore, you have to get it off the statute books. Example is Taiwan. Who executes every now and then one, two, three, four people a year maybe? A few months ago in Taiwan, it was actually in June, a girl at school had her throat cut. It's a terrible crime. The nation was poor. She was just a young girl. They demanded the death penalty, but for whom? So the government just pulled six prisoners off death row, unrelated to the crime in every way, totally unrelated to the crime, and within a few days executed them to satisfy their community lust for some kind of death vengeance.
So look, Julian's been on his feet for 1 hour and 15 minutes, so let's thank him very much.